Thank you, Mayor. Thank you so much. Well, this is the moment we've all been waiting for. It's not every day. In fact, it's quite rare. And it's quite important and amazing when we're able to have a Justice of the United States Supreme Court join us here in Los Angeles at Loyola Law School. We are so proud that Justice Anthony Kennedy has agreed to be our keynote speaker for today. Justice Kennedy himself is a native of California, Northern California, a graduate of Stanford University and of Harvard Law School. He served on the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeal, and when he joined it, he was the youngest appellate judge in the nation. He is known and still known as a patient and brilliant jurist. I know. He was patient with me when I argued my first case in front of the Ninth Circuit. And I thought he was brilliant when he affirmed my decision as well. Justice Kennedy has been a professor both in the United States and abroad. And in 1988, he was appointed to the United States Supreme Court. He is a force for justice and reform. And in 2003, he gave the keynote address to the ABA, which led to the creation of the Kennedy Commission on Criminal Justice, which focuses on reforms in criminal corrections and rehabilitation. We are extremely grateful and proud that he has agreed to be the keynote speaker today. With great pride, I present to you United States Supreme Court Justice Anthony Kennedy.
Thank you very much. Your Honor, the Mayor, President Burton, Dean Gold, Mr. Girardi, Judge Collins, Judge Levinson, and of course, my dear colleague in the federal judiciary, Art Alarcón. Thank you very much for inviting me to share this moment, this event. This historic beginning of a new chapter in the state law school and its history. Now, I was appointed to the Court of Appeals before Judge Alarcón, and so in theory and the way it goes in the federal system, I was senior to Judge Alarcón. Now, that is a sheer fiction, because it came clear to me after I first sat with Judge Alarcón, that here was a judge and a lawyer and a human who by temperament, learning, humor, rationality, decency, was my role model and my senior in every real respect. Talk about advocacy. You know, judges, we don't pound tables, but we sometimes very get excited. But if you're excited in front of Art Alarcón in the conference room, you say, "Now, wait a minute, let's talk about this." And he has this wonderful, soft-spoken approach, this marvelous smile, this gentleness, this decency, which are the hallmark of a really great judge. Now, when you first think about it, it might be somewhat surprising that you would name an advocacy center after a judge. I mean, what's going on here? There are two simple reasons to explain this, and then another one which requires a little more explanation. The simple reasons are first. Judge Alarcón was a fine advocate at the bar, and he's taught advocacy. The second is that his motto, and he tells this to the young people, to the students, President Burton and Dean Gold, whom he teaches, that what you should do as a lawyer is to ask this question: who needs my help today? And I hope that you can put this someplace in the Alarcón Advocacy Center, because that is the purpose and the meaning and the mission of the Alarcón Advocacy Center. Now, the other point is that judging and advocacy are not that far apart anyway. To begin with, we are products of the bar. It's the Anglo-American tradition. The judges come from ranks of the practicing bar. This is not true in most parts of the world. And so we know the dynamic. We know the purpose. We know the strategy. And we know the utility of excellent advocacy. The dynamic of judging and of arguing cases is somewhat different, of course. An advocate has to make decisions very quickly in the course of cross-examination. Which way should I turn? In the course of deciding whether to produce a certain item of evidence or to make a certain objection, there's a temporal dynamic there that lawyers love, that most of us still miss. But when it comes to appellate judging, to be on the Court of Appeals for the Ninth Circuit or to my own court, the dynamic is different. To begin with, there's somewhat more time. There's the opportunity for debate, for reasoned discussion, for reflection, leading up to a statement of reasons. Now, His Honor the Mayor talked about the fractious, hostile, divisive nature of our civil discourse today. And sometimes people look at lawyers and they see advocates and they think they're just copying this and that they're doing what we're doing, but there's a difference. Because in the legal system, advocacy is for the purpose of coming soon to a specific, concrete resolution of a problem with a statement of reasons in support of the result. And that's what appellate courts do in a language and with a tradition that has a formalism and a precedent and a history and a constraint. And we think an elegance and an eloquence that is different from the trial courts and certainly different from our civil discourse generally. But judges who must make difficult decisions do so recognizing that their reasons, which are the foundation of their opinions, rest upon the advocacy that precedes it. When a judicial opinion is written, it is designed to command allegiance to the result, to design to instill inspiration and respect for the legal system. And it's only because those written decisions are preceded by this foundation of advocacy that we have the confidence that we might just gain the allegiance, we might just succeed. Lawyers have no, pardon me, judges have no public relations budget. We don't give a press conference saying how great our dissent was last week. We are judged by what we write. But what we write is the result of advocacy, of zealous advocacy, of principled advocacy. On the plane coming out here, I had some background about Judge Alarcón. And it's part of that background where I found that he told those for whom he is the mentor that their purpose ought to be to ask always, who needs my help today? But I also found out that he was a fan of the author Michael Connelly. And I allow myself to read one or two potboilers in the summer. And early this summer on my way to Europe, I read Michael Connelly's book, The Lincoln Lawyer. And it would be very familiar to many of you because his protagonist usually is a defense counsel who lives in Los Angeles. And so the geography and the courts and the dynamic of the police system are familiar to many of you. He's an admirable, skillful writer. Oh, and incidentally, I recommend it to those of you who are interested in trial practice because he has a quite sophisticated and insightful discussion of the purposes and the strategies of cross-examination. But I remember, and I'm pretty sure it's the last line of the book, the lawyer, defense counsel, has gone through a very difficult time. And there are multiple clients that he's concerned with, a client who previously was convicted and sentenced to a long term, and who basically has a life term because of the AIDS that he contracted in prison against his consent. And the client that's more immediate to the plot. And at the end, this lawyer who's been injured reflects that in 3 or 4 months, he'll be able to come back. And he says in what I think is the last line of the book, he was prepared to go back to stand in the world without proof. Now, it's the hallmark of a skillful writer that he sometimes puts words into the mouth of the protagonist that he himself may or may not believe. But I thought that was a very provocative and a very incorrect statement about the purposes and the heritage and the function and the meaning of the law. Of course, there are certain values, certain ethical principles, certain moral principles, certain cardinal precepts that are constant in our profession. This is the meaning of justice, and this is the meaning of truth. And I hope that the Alarcón Center will teach our generations of young lawyers that you must be unyielding in defense of the rights of your client, and that you must be fearless in the pursuit of truth, a truth that may be elusive, but that sometimes you can see and perhaps sometimes even grasp for yourself and for our own times. And it is with these brief remarks that I suggest we once again understand that this dedication to our Alarcón Legal Center is a time for us to rededicate ourselves to those principles and to the principles that our Alarcón has so long defended and embodied as a great jurist. Thank you very, very much.